So here is just one example of what happens when it's a time of crisis for the child, is when the child has acute diarrhea. There is a study from Delhi which shows that girls are much, much more likely to die of diarrhea than boys. So the disease is the same, but the action, swift action is needed to rehydrate the child, bring them to the health center, and girls are just much more likely to die of that than girls, showing that parents are not as likely to make the hard decision. So that's in the direction of the child. Another possible crisis is crisis for the family, when the family comes in a hard time. And there is a very influential, very interesting paper by Elena Rose, which showed that in the differential between girl and boys' mortality increases in period of drought. This is India again. So in general, girls are somewhat more likely to die than boys, which might come from the fact that in case of crisis, parents are less likely to help them out. But when there is a drought, that difference increases many folds. So when there is a drought and the family is really hit a constraint, if they have to feed one of the child, they feed the boy rather than the girl. Another example of that, not for kids now, but for adults, is a paper by Edward Miguel showing that in Tanzania, in periods of droughts, there are suspicious epidemics of killing witches. Who are witches? Now, old women who are sort of not particularly helpful and relevant in period of drought. And in period of drought, you see that suddenly these old witches need to be taken care of. So what does this imply? It implies that if we could reduce vulnerability, either through the provision of cash transfer to poor households, or insurance, or access to credit, then this could reduce gender discrimination even without targeting women in particular. Because if it's only in times where the households get really close to the subsistence threshold that they start making these decisions that go against girls, if we remove these occasions, then we'll have fewer girls dying. And a sign of that is that, two signs of that actually, is that in South Africa, when they introduced the old age pension program, many fewer witches got killed. South Africa has the same witch killing problem. And the witch killing epidemics went down after the introduction of old age pension. Because when your witch happens to be also getting an old age pension, there are some reasons to try and keep her alive. Another example of that is if you go back to the Elena Rose paper, the phenomenon that I spoke about, that in drought, girls are much more likely to die than boys, is only there for households that are landless. When households have some land, that relationship doesn't appear. So when households have some land, they have some buffer. So if they're hit by a shock, they will sell land before killing their daughter. And that suggests that improving, relaxing this grip of poverty might in itself help the girls more than the boys, just because they're the ones who suffer the most from poverty. So that's the first reason why you might see improving development would just be good for women, disproportionately be good for women. Another reason, another class of reason why you might see this effect, you might see that economic development would be better for women than for men, it would be good for men too, but it would be even better for women, is that development, in particular integration into the world economy, diversification of the economy, will improve the opportunities that are available to women. So think about a small community which are providing wheat, so the work is quite physically intensive, so maybe boys are just better at doing that than girls. When you suddenly improve, are able to access either national or international markets, there are different type of things that people can start doing. So if women can start working, for example, in BPOs, this is something that requires no strength, so they are particularly good at it. And so you start now seeing more opportunities for your girls as a parent. And that has two consequences. One is you're more likely to want to stick them around, to make sure that they are around, to take advantage of those opportunities. And second, you're more likely to want to invest in them so that they can take advantage of those opportunities. So the returns to education, the returns to investment in health, et cetera, increase. And therefore, that gives people incentive to try and invest in their girls. That again is disproportionately for girls, just because the diversification naturally is moving away from the brown to the brain, if you want, that will help women disproportionately. Not because they have more brain, but because they have less brown. So some example of that, that it's not only something that I made up as a theoretical possibility. One is a very interesting paper by Nancy Chen, which showed that the household responsibility system in China, which introduced for households that were in tea-producing region, or at least in regions suitable to produce tea, with the household responsibility system, it became possible for this household to start growing tea. Before that, they were not really allowed to grow it, or if they grow it, they couldn't sell it at market prices. And it turns out that women have a comparative advantage relative to men in plucking tea, because you don't need to be particularly strong, but you need to have nimble finger. And so that improved the relative standing of women relative to men, and in turn, that improved the chances of survival of girls born in this cohort in the tea-producing region relative to other regions. Another example of a related phenomenon is a paper by Kevin Munchi and Mark Rosenzweig, which looked at the entry of India in the world economy and the impact that it had on girls in Bombay. So what they look at is a quite traditional group of lower caste households, which used to keep their daughters at home and send their boys to Marathi language schools, the vernacular language schools. With the introduction of the opportunity to work in these call centers and things like that, it became valuable to speak English. And women and men were equally good at doing that. So they started sending their girls to school in English. Their boys too, but not that much, because they wanted to keep one link with the caste as a social network. So they continued sending the boys to the Marathi school. The girls went to the English schools, so that eventually the girls more than catch up with the girls, because with the Marathi school, with the Marathi language education, it's a bit harder to get a job in a call center subsequently. So the diversification had helped the girls actually leapfrog their brothers in this case. Here is another example of that. Ongoing work by Rob Jensen, which is a field experiment, where what he did is that he sent some teams to recruit girls to work in call centers in villages around Delhi. And what he found is that several years later, the call center's recruitment drive led to an increase in enrollment of girls in schools and an improvement in girls' weight for height, which is a measure of nutrition. There was also an improvement for boys, but it was lower, because again, the girls need to catch up from wherever level they are at. So that's another class of explanation. A third class of explanation is that development makes it worthwhile for men to give more rights to women, maybe on their own. So one of the dimensions where women are lagging behind in many countries, particularly developing countries, is access to political rights and voting rights, although the voting rights is improving in a lot of places. So what you see is that there is a very strong correlation between the income of a country and how many rights the women have, in particular rights to own property, what happens to kids in case of divorce and things like that. So, of course, the causality could go both ways. If we see a relationship between income and gender rights, you could say, well, it's because gender rights increase income, for the reasons we are going to see a little later in this lecture. Or you could think it's because income increases gender rights. And there are good theoretical reasons to think that economic growth could indeed lead men, who are at the beginning of all the rights, to voluntarily surrender some rights to their wives. And there are two classes of argument. One argument is made by Dupke and Tertilt. What they explain is that, well, suppose there is economic growth, then it is worthwhile to have healthy and well-educated children so that they can take advantage of those opportunities. So you want to invest more in your children. But let's suppose, hypothetically, and we're going to prove it very soon, that women care more about children than men. And that in the family there is some inefficiency such that if women have more power, a little bit more investment will be made in kids.